Hello, namaste, and welcome to Delhi. I'm Devina, and this is Work Life India on the BBC, the show that looks at all things to do with money, the work we do, and the lives we lead. Now, did you know that at any given point of time, at least 40 million people across the world are forced to live their lives without the freedom to make their own choices? They're exploited for labor or sexual favors without their consent, forced to work and live in conditions contrary to human dignity. Yes, the hidden world of modern slavery is a reality of our times. So we are asking, can we eradicate modern day slavery? According to the Global Slavery Index, there are an estimated 18 million people living in modern slavery in India, a statistic that the government here still questions. But what is the reality on the ground? And what is the way forward? To talk more about it, we have with us Colin Gonsalves, a senior advocate in India's top court, whose organization rescues forced labor. Welcome, Colin.
Hi, Devina. Happy to be here.
Thank you, Colin, for being here. We have lots of questions for you. And we also have Riya Singh, who is a young female activist and who is working in a very unique caste-based system of India and is fighting oppression here. Welcome, Riya.
Thank you, Devina.
And we also have Manoj Bhatt, who is the country director of GoodWeave, an organization that is trying to spread awareness about slave labor in global supply chain. A tough job, Manoj. Welcome.
Good evening.
Well, let's start with you then, Colin. According to the Global Slavery Index, 18 million modern slaves in India, that's say about 1.4% of Indian population. Why is the figure so high?
Well, I always thought that this figure is actually very, very low.
Is that so?
If you look at the Arjun Sen Gupta report, a central government report some years ago, it said there were 300 million people in the informal sector. Now, the informal sector is a sector where the law doesn't cover anybody at all. No minimum wages, no health services, nothing. Now, 300 million people without legal coverage, migrating, being trafficked, and so on. And 18 million bonded labor doesn't fit. My sort of guess, and I think it would be an enlightened guess, is that one third, at least one third of unorganized workers would be in the category of bonded labor.
That's about
100 million people.
That's
and I must tell you, 100 million people seems to me also on the low side, which means you're dealing with a country of slaves.
Really, Manoj, do you agree? 100 million people, according to Colin, who are living in conditions of modern slavery in India?
I think it's really difficult to even estimate how many people are there. So there are different reports coming up with different figures. But Colin is right. I mean, the informal sector,
which is 85 to 90% of India's workforce is actually an informal sector.
Yeah.
But that actually means higher than the global figures of 40 million. So how are we defining modern slavery? How are you defining it when you say that this figure might be right?
Yeah, as you know, we know that 80% and more than that is in the informal sector, and very difficult to estimate how many people are actually living and working in forced conditions. But the way we define it, people who are actually producing for market, doing something, either a service or some manufacturing work, which is done for market. And if they are not treated with dignity and forced to work, they would be considered.
I would actually pick up the word forced more, saying that forced involuntary work is modern slavery. How is it different, Riya, in the Indian context? Because if you look at the Global Slavery Index, and that's the definition that I would go back to again and again during the course of the show, because that's the index which is available for our consumption. North Korea, Eritrea, Burundi are top three countries when it comes to having modern slavery. In India's context, how is it different? Because most of these states are defined again by this organization that these are state-sponsored forced labor. In India, how is it different?
See, people are habitual of looking at slavery as something where people are bounded or mm-hmm. they are forced. So now, I think that's a very narrow definition of understanding what slavery means like. So in modern India, the forms have changed. So for example, it is not necessary that you find laborers who are chained. That's a very traditional form of slavery that people will look at. So I think in India and also globally, I would categorize, and also other people have categorized slavery as where people of certain category are forced to do particular kind of work, like they're involved in unclean professions. So across globe, there are particular tribes or caste or groups who are forced into the sanitation work. So Asia Dalit Rights Forum, they did a research on 13 countries, and they found out that in India, it's a case of caste where people are forced into sanitation work through manual scavenging and other sorts of sanitation work in public departments and public toilets. Across globe, any country, so cleaning is a necessity. It's an everyday affair.
But let me say that there are rules against manual scavenging, which has been banned in India. Constitutionally, bonded labor is banned in India. Constitutionally, also untouchability, which you refer to as caste system, where lower caste people weren't allowed to enter homes or were pushed into certain profession, is banned in India. So Colin, I'll go back to the first question I asked you. Why do we have modern slavery in India?
Because we have a law, we have constitution, we have all kinds of regulations, but nobody implements any regulation. Mm-hmm. Government doesn't see bondage and slavery as a serious problem to be tackled. Why should it? If people are starving and working in menial operations and working in brick kilns, 10 million in brick kilns, if there are 50 million in domestic workers who are not covered by law, government doesn't care. We must try and understand. We seem to think that, oh, it's a huge problem, so government should get on the job. No government since independence mm-hmm. has bothered to clear up bonded labor because they don't see it either as a social or economic problem. It's just for the media to be handled so that the image of India is maintained. If people live in bondage, how will it affect our GDP? If people live and starve, 50 million people in India, 50% of the population in India, starving, malnourished by any data that you look at, does anybody care? So everyone's thinking about production, everyone's thinking about entrepreneurship, everyone's thinking about corporate houses and GDP. But if GDP is your only concern, then what does it matter if people die of hunger or disease or whatever it is? So slavery is not a concern in India.
Especially, you're saying, in a capitalist economy where businesses are looking to cut costs. And I would say, as media house and a responsible one, we have actually done some reporting, and I want to show our audience and the viewers and the audience that's joining us on the BBC World Service as well, because broadly, modern slavery is divided into forced labor and forced marriage. So we've taken forced labor, and you spoke about brick units, Colin, and we actually went on the ground to do some reportage on this. As you drive through India's countryside, you will find small brick-making units dotting the landscape. These are basically huge furnaces which harden mud clay into bricks. Workers mold the clay with their hands, but some factory owners cut down costs by using bonded labor. WorkLife India's Sulika Bhatnagar spoke with former brick unit workers who were rescued recently.
He lured us. He said, "What can you earn here? Come with me, you'll get very good income." I started work at 4 in the morning and continued till about 9 at night. There was only one lunch break in between. I would mold the clay, dry it, prepare it for burning. It was a lot of work, not a single minute of rest. Yet the brick kiln owner forced me to make 3,500 bricks every day. If I fell sick, his guards would scold me and beat me up.
They tortured me a lot. They beat me up daily for different reasons. You didn't make enough bricks. This brick isn't good enough. The clay isn't properly molded. They came up with such excuses. I'm a simple farming man. I just want to go home.
So Colin, one of the workers actually said that she made 3,500 bricks, would work for 17 hours, and it's actually your organization that helped rescue some of them.
Why is it that most of them are undetected? And take us through the time when you go and rescue them. Are authorities responsive when you tell them that there is a problem of abandoned labor in this brick making unit and we want to rescue these people?
Well, look at the situation. The owner of a brick kiln is actually a gunda. He's actually a mafia kind of guy, right? He and his friends surround the brick kiln. Can you get in and rescue people? No. Will a labor inspector come in there? No. Can you take their cases up in court? No. When you rescue them, you're at the mercy of the local police who must help you. Mm-hmm. Most often than not, they will not help you because they are friends with the brick kiln owner. And you're lucky if you can get the police to help you. Once you rescue them, that's another nightmare because they don't have clothes, they don't have food. You've got to get their release certificates from the authorities. And the authorities fight you tooth and nail because brick kiln owners are financially very powerful.
Mm-hmm.
So that's your struggle. We struggle and manage to get several hundreds out, but we are a drop in the bucket.
Hmm.
Nobody rescues bonded labor in this country. Nobody
Manoj
rescues
Manoj does, because
workers.
Manoj, you actually have an alternative model, because what Colin is saying, yes, there is a nexus usually between the owners of these brick-making units and the local authorities. These were few lucky ones that your organization was able to rescue. There's a question of rehabilitating them. You have an alternative model that you have tried in Nepal that has been quite successful.
Yes. So it's a matter of engaging all the stakeholders and making sure that the bricklayers are able to see the bigger picture, and the authorities are also engaged. The workers are empowered to talk about things.
Mm-hmm.
So if you do all these things and create something which the bricklayers have to follow,
mm-hmm.
and build a market pressure on the bricklayers, it is possible. It's not going to improve overnight, but you can at least start a process of improving the working conditions of workers. Because the authorities and the market and the civil society, if can come together to improve, it is possible.
But tell me something, and Riya, this is a question to you, because a lot of times there is another side of the argument. Why is it that you are blaming the brick kiln owners, because what they're doing is giving them a job? And why is it that there are no more jobs for people, an alternative option, and that's why they're doing this, what they're doing? That's the opportunity either to be employed or to starve.
See, when people are left with no alternative opportunity, they're bound to get into these professions. So for example, if we talk about manual scavenging, so government has a scheme which allocates money every year for budget. So like this year, they have allocated 110 crores for rehabilitation of manual scavengers. So, and if there was an RTI report, so until 2018...
Right information, application,
yes,
is
2018,
what you're talking
about. Until 2018, September, 60 crore rupees for the rehabilitation scheme is unused. So there's a scheme that exists that these...
Billions of dollars that have been allocated
scavengers would be taken out from their work, and this money has to be used to give them skills. This money has to be used to give them jobs. There's an alternative, so the government also proposes that we'll give them equivalent jobs in government sectors. That's not done. So when your rehabilitation also fails, eventually where does the worker go? He gets reinstated in the same work again because he needs salary. He needs to run the house. So I think this is the biggest failure, that even after having money allocated via government, now what is missing here? So government has recognized this is a problem. They have allocated money for it.
Mm-hmm.
And now they're not releasing the money.
Mm-hmm.
So I think now the state lacks the political will to actually abolish it. So you have got the
resource. But manual scavenging is abolished in India. And mm-hmm. that's where the change is, that there have been laws. And I think Colin spoke about this earlier, that there are laws that are there in India. But still, it's a choice of survival. That's the question. It's a choice of survival. Well, let me take you through another example, because we also went and spoke to someone who was engaged in family work as a child, just 13 years old. Her name is Rani, where children are particularly vulnerable in rural areas. They're often under pressure to work with their families for extra income because it is about survival. WorkLife India's Medhavi Arora spoke with this child, Rani, from India's largest state, Uttar Pradesh. She started doing embroidery at home to earn money when she was just 13 years old.
Often there are children in hidden supply chains. When a girl starts embroidery work at the age of 12, she's still a child at that age. She's not grown up yet. Consumers don't know that there are children involved in manufacturing the products. They only know that their products are being made in Delhi or in India. But they don't understand that in these products made in India, there are children from poor families involved in the supply chain, working on these products to bring them to you. When child laborers see other children going to school, they think, had we finished our education, we could have progressed. We'll probably be stuck working our entire lives. There is nothing else to life but work.
Well, Rani is 22 years old now, and she's working with your foundation, Manoj, and you've been able to rehabilitate her. But she made a very important point that why are consumers buying these products? Because if you look at globally, G20 countries, and this is again a figure from Global Slavery Index, import about $354 billion at-risk products. The US alone is responsible for $145 billion of these imports. How do you ensure that global supply chains are clean for businesses?
See, the most important aspect is that the global companies are not aware where their product is actually being made. So Rani works in a hidden supply chain. It is informal, but also hidden. And it is hidden by people deliberately because the working conditions are not good. Children may be working. The wages are very low. So the task here is to educate companies who are buying from India that their work may not be happening in the main factories only. And there is a huge informal sector which requires to be, you know, seen and supported to make sure that their products are risk-free.
Mm-hmm.
So our organization, GoodWeave, works with companies to make it happen. And through the global brands, we reach out to the last tier of the production, that is people like
Rani. And do you monitor this constantly?
We monitor, we have a monitoring system. And that monitoring system is done randomly. That monitoring system is based on the standards, no child labor, no forced labor, and the supply chain should be documented.
How many businesses are actually open for this idea? Because Colin, in your experience as well, when you've spoken about these issues, are businesses open to address these issues or are they looking more to cut down their costs?
I think abroad, the corporations would be aghast. Generally, if they came to know that their product has been made by little hands of slavery, is there? But in India, does anybody care? I don't think. And if you look at the buildings in India, all the bricks, I think half the bricks of the buildings that are being made in India are from bricks coming from Rajasthan and Haryana and the neighboring states, and quite probably with child labor and bonded labor. Do Indians, it's a question we should ask ourselves. To us, middle-class Indians, upper-class Indians, educated, elite, do we really care?
But do we really care, Riya? Would you look for a product tag on the dress that you're wearing right now, whether it's a risk-free product?
I think I wouldn't. In India, I think people are habitual of involuntary servitude. So the caste system allows you to have free service provided to the upper-caste people. So what worker is doing, what condition he's working in, how much money that worker is getting, is not a concern of a consumer who's paying money for
services.
Yes,
but there are affirmative actions being taken legally as well and constitutionally as well to deconstruct this caste system. The question is, for example, in the US, you have Nike, you have Gap, two major chains, where there were cases of protest by consumers and accusations that there were products made in sweatshops in faraway countries. And both these organizations were then forced to internally audit and promise that they would make risk-free products. Do we see that in India? Do we see that awareness in the Indian consumers like you and me?
I think we are not willing to look at this.
We are not. Manoj, you have a point?
Because we work with businesses every day. So we are able to see a positive picture as well.
Okay.
And we interact with consumers as well. So we see that people have interest. The only thing is how to consolidate it and make sure that it grows.
So what's the solution? But before that, I want to actually focus on the second part of modern slavery, which is about forced marriage. Because globally, 71% of modern slaves are women and girls. Forced marriage, or the practice of bride trafficking, is a serious problem in the southern Indian city of Hyderabad. I traveled to Hyderabad to speak with young Muslim Indian girls who were sold into marriage to rich men from Arab countries, only to be exploited and then abandoned. We have concealed their identities at their request. Here are the stories.
I remember there was a big car outside our home. There was good food and I was dressed in bright clothes with a lot of glitter. I was just 13 years old and felt very nice. I danced with my friends too. I didn't know that I was a bride. I didn't understand it was a wedding ceremony. After some time, I was asked to sit in a car and we went to a hotel. That's where my mother told me that the man standing next to me was my husband. I started crying, but no one listened to me. After almost a week at the hotel, he left the country. 3 months later, I realized I was pregnant. My mother locked me in a room, and that's where I gave birth to a girl. I'm 30 years old now, and I haven't met that man ever again.
The marriage agent knew my father and said he would get a lot of money. They took me to a hotel with a big hall. There were around 50 men sitting on chairs. There was one chair placed in the middle. They asked me to sit there. One of the men said he liked me and wanted to marry me. I was just 12 years old. I was taken to a home where my groom was waiting for me. He was 75 years old. He sexually harassed me and even filmed me during that time. After 20 days, he left the country, but came back at least twice. He wanted to take me with him and pass me around to his friends. That's when I decided to run away.
Well, Colin, this is the reality right now. $700 is what one of them told me was paid to her parents so that she can be married to this man. It's called Sheikh Nikah. And there are at least 1,000 cases that are registered with the cops for last year. And these are just cases that are registered. Why are we seeing that there is a fear with these women? And what is the solution? What is the solution to break this chain right now?
Yeah, let me tell you what I think is the solution. The core of the solution lies in organizing. The core of the solution lies in NGOs proliferating, going out into the countryside, capturing or releasing bonded laborers and taking them to the authorities and freeing them. Mm-hmm. Combined with a legal strategy, which will ensure that they remain free and that they will be rehabilitated. That's the core. Struggle plus the law.
Manoj, and I want to come to you because earlier you mentioned that there is a good business solution because where consumers and businesses could have a win-win. There are laws in the UK, in Australia this year, in fact, where businesses are asked after a certain turnover to publish their reports on their dealings in global supply chain and what are the steps being taken to deal with modern slavery. And they're penalized. So is that something we can implement in India?
Yeah, definitely. And you know, because there is a momentum. The California, transparency law, and France and Netherlands are also moving in that direction.
Okay.
But there is a global momentum for making sure that the businesses play a positive
role. So can it be done in India? Yes or no?
It can be done, and it
should
be done.
But there are challenges.
Yes.
All right.
In addition to that, I think promoting right to education strongly is very important.
All right. Thank you so much for joining us. I'm afraid I'm completely out of time, but thank you for joining us. Do tweet with hashtag WorkLifeIndia to tell us about your feedback. Thank you.